Good evening and welcome to the WDSU Hot Seat. I'm Norman Robinson. Some good news and not so good news for you tonight. Just recently, New Orleans was named in a national study as one of the fastest growing cities with populations over 100,000 in the country. That report comes on the heels of another less encouraging report concerning poverty in the area. Tonight we're talking or taking a close look at both, but particularly poverty. I'm joined now by Allison Plyer with the Greater New Orleans Community Data Center and Dr. Lance Hill with Tulane's Southern Institute for Education and Research. Thank you both for joining us. Let's get right to it, shall we?
Sure.
This data indicates that the city of New Orleans and the South Louisiana region have about 50,000 fewer poor residents post-Hurricane Katrina. Is that because conditions have gotten better for the poor, Ms. Plyer?
No, I would say that that means that most, from other studies, we know that the poor tended to be displaced the farthest and so had the most difficulty returning. So what we find is that if they were displaced perhaps within the region, they might have, that we're not showing appreciable increases. And it's possible some of them found some economic opportunities in the suburban areas because of so much Katrina rebuilding. But we still have incredibly high poverty rates, much higher than the nation. And so, and mostly what we see, even though we've had a reduction in poverty, is that they've been displaced beyond the Southeast Louisiana region.
What does that stat say to you, Dr. Hill?
Well, it's not surprising. I think in the last year, the data has been a little more startling. Every year, the Census Bureau does a survey. And last year, in that survey, the poverty rate for New Orleans was at the same rate as it was for 1999. In other words, there are more people living in poverty, a higher percentage of people, individuals living in poverty today than before Katrina. And among African Americans, that goes to 37% compared to 14% of whites. So it's about three times as likely. So something that I think really should have been a top-fold front-page story, that in the midst of some $142 billion being spent in recovery, that we're actually increasing the percentage of poverty in the city of New Orleans.
But we get all these glowing reports, Ms. Plyer, about how well the city of New Orleans is doing compared to the other regions. In fact, I remember reading a stat that says that the job growth in New Orleans, especially high tech, is on the uptick. Well, what's happening, and how does that compare, and how do you reconcile those kind of stats with these debilitating stats that we're reading about increased poverty?
Right, right. No, I think Dr. Hill is exactly right. You know, the yearly numbers on poverty show that poverty went from 27% and then down to about 21% in 2007 because of so many displaced people. And now it's back up to the same as it was a decade ago. And so what that says is, although poor people have not been able to return, we know that tens of thousands are still displaced. But people who were not poor before Katrina are now poor. And you're saying, you know, given all the rebuilding activity, how can that be the case? And I think, you know, when we look at what those companies are saying who are coming here to do those high-tech jobs is that they're not finding the skills in the workforce that they need. And so they oftentimes bring workers with them instead of hiring our local folks. So although we might have had some success in creating jobs, we really need to have a much more robust workforce training system for our local residents.
Now, let me play the devil's advocate here. People in suburbia might say, well, we're attracting the poor the poor and working poor because we do a better job of servicing them. Mm-hmm. What would you say to that?
Well, can I return to your question about the high tech first? Is that there is no greater myth in New Orleans today than that we have a growing high tech sector.
So you say that's a myth?
Absolute myth. It started about 2 years ago when a company called Praxis did a study that said that New Orleans was among the 10 fastest growing technology cities. Now, you can go from 5 technology jobs to 10 and be the fastest growing. Put it in perspective, there are 16,000 technology jobs in New Orleans today. There are 200,000 in Dallas. If you look at Dice.com that advertises technology jobs and you put in software program writer, you get 6 jobs being advertised in New Orleans. You get 580 in Dallas. You get over 100 in Austin. It simply doesn't exist, and it's a problem. I'll come back to it in this, is that if we think that there's a growth sector and we begin to allocate resources and even organize our education system around filling that particular growth sector, and it's not. That, in fact, there are other parts of our economy, the tourist economy, where the growth probably will happen, then we're burying our head in the sand and we're just going to reproduce poverty.
Would you like to tackle the question about whether the suburbs are doing a better job of servicing the poor and working poor?
Well, no, actually, I think that really none of us are doing a good job of assisting poor and doing poverty alleviation. I mean, one of the things that we've been looking at over the last several years is the suburbanization of poverty. So while, poverty went down post-Katrina, then went back up in the city, it has continued to go up in the suburbs. And this is happening nationwide. And so some of what happens in that regard is that you see jobs moving to the suburbs. A lot of them are retail jobs. A lot of them pay minimum wage. But a full-time minimum wage job does not pull you out of poverty. And we know that 40% of the people in poverty in our region actually work, of the working age adults. And two-thirds of them work full-time, year-round jobs. And so we definitely need to have a more robust economic development system that builds, as Dr. Lance says, on our strengths. Our digital media is a very small part. It's exciting. People like to talk about it, but it's very small. And we have really important assets like energy, oil and gas, port and logistics that pay good wages and that are really built on our core strengths.
So do you get the sense that this sort of, I'm going to refer to it as, I'm going to categorize it as the outsourcing of the poor.
Mm-hmm.
Is that by design? Is that a strategy?
Well, I think after Katrina, it was sometimes spoken openly in the Wall Street Journal on September 8th of 2005. There was an article about making the city smaller, reducing the footprint, changing it, making it more affluent and more wider. And I think there was a movement afoot to export poverty, to make sure that people did not come back that were seen as a burden. And the problem with that is that you don't solve the problem of poverty in New Orleans or where you export it to. If you send someone to Houston that can't read or write, they can't read or write in Houston. They can't fill out an application in Houston. And when you come back to New Orleans, if you haven't addressed the issues that created poverty for poor people, then when they come back here, they're simply going to reproduce it as well.
All right, we have to take a pause right now, but when we come back, we're going to tackle this question. To what degree does the lack of affordable housing force the poor and working poor to suburbia? Don't go far.